The Golden Cup and the Dish of Silver by Thomas Hood. This is a LibriVox recording. All LibriVox recordings are in the public domain. For more information, or to volunteer, please visit LibriVox.org. Everyone knows what a dog's life the miserable Jews lead all over the world, but especially among the Turks, who plunder them of their riches and slay them on the most frivolous pretences. Thus, if they acquire any wealth, they are obliged to hide it in holes and corners, and to snatch their scanty enjoyments by stealth, in recompense of the buffets and contumely of their turbaned oppressors. In this manner lived Yusuf, a Hebrew of great wealth and wisdom, but, outwardly, a poor beggarly druggist, inhabiting with his wife Anna one of the meanest houses in Constantinople. The curse of his nation had often fallen bitterly upon his head, his great skill in medicine procuring him some uncertain favour from the Turks, but on the failure of his remedies a tenfold proportion of ill usage and contempt. In such cases, 100 blows on the soles of his feet were his common payment, whereas on the happiest cures he was often dismissed with empty hands and some epithet of disgrace. As he was sitting one day at his humble door, thinking over these miseries, a Janissary came up to him and commanded Yusuf to go with him to his aga, or captain, whose palace was close at hand. Yusuf's gold immediately weighed heavy as his heart as the cause of this summons. However, he rose obediently and followed the soldier to the aga, who was sitting cross-legged on a handsome carpet with his long pipe in his mouth. The Jew, casting himself on his knees with his face to the floor, began, like his brethren, to plead poverty in excuse for the shabbiness of his appearance. But the aga, interrupting him, proceeded to compliment him in a flattering strain on his reputation for wisdom, which he said had made him desirous of his conversation. He then ordered the banquet to be brought in, whereupon the slaves put down before them some wine in a golden cup, and some pork in a dish of silver, both of which were forbidden things, and therefore made the Jew wonder very much at such an entertainment. The aga then, pointing to the refreshments, addressed him as follows: "Yusuf, they say you are a very wise and learned man, and have studied deeper than any one the mysteries of nature. I have sent for you, therefore, to resolve me on certain doubts concerning this flesh and this liquor before us. The pork being as abominable to your religion as the wine is unto ours. But I am especially curious to know the reasons why your prophet should have forbidden a meat which, by report of the Christians, is both savoury and wholesome. Wherefore I will have you proceed first with that argument, and, in order that you may not discuss it negligently, I am resolved, in case you fail to justify the prohibition, that you shall empty the silver dish before you stir from the place. Nevertheless, to show you that I am equally candid, I promise, if you shall thereafter prove to me the unreasonableness of the injunction against wine, I will drink off this golden goblet as frankly before we part." The terrified Jew understood very readily the purpose of this trial. However, after a secret prayer to Moses, he began in the best way he could to plead against the abominable dish that was steaming under his nostrils. He failed, notwithstanding, to convince the sceptical aga, who, therefore, commanded him to eat up the pork and then begin his discourse in favour of the wine. The sad Jew, at this order, endeavoured to move the obdurate Turk by his tears, but the aga was resolute, and drawing his crooked scimitar, declared that if Yusuf did not instantly fall to, he would smite his head from his shoulders. It was time, at this threat, for Yusuf to commend his soul unto heaven, for in Turkey the Jews wear their heads very loosely. However, by dint of fresh tears and supplications, he obtained a respite of 3 days to consider if he could not bring forward any further arguments. As soon as the audience was over, Yusuf returned disconsolately to his house and informed his wife Anna of what had passed between him and the Aga. The poor woman foresaw clearly how the matter would end, for it was aimed only at the confiscation of their riches. She advised Yusuf, therefore, instead of racking his wits for fresh arguments, to carry a bag of gold to the Aga, who condescended to receive his reasons, and after another brief discourse, to grant him a respite of 3 days longer. In the same manner, Yusuf procured a further interval, but somewhat dearer, so that in despair at losing his money at this rate, he returned for the fourth time to the palace. The Aga and Yusuf, being seated as before with the mess of pork and the wine between them, the Turk asked if he had brought any fresh arguments. The doctor replied, alas, he had already discussed the subject so often that his reasons were quite exhausted. Whereupon the flashing scimitar, leaping quickly out of its scabbard, the trembling Hebrew plucked the loathsome dish towards him, and with many struggles began to eat. It cost him 1,000 wry faces to swallow the first morsel, and from the laughter that came from behind a silken screen, they were observed by more mockers beside the Aga, who took such a cruel pleasure in the amusement of his women that Yusuf was compelled to proceed even to the licking of the dish. He was then suffered to depart, without wasting any logic upon the cup of wine, which after his loathsome meal he would have been quite happy to discuss. I guess not how the Jew consoled himself, besides, for his involuntary sin, but he bitterly cursed the cruel Aga and all his wives, who could not amuse their indolent lives with their dancing girls and tale-tellers, but made merry at the expense of his soul. His wife joined heartily in his imprecations, and both, putting ashes on their heads, they mourned and cursed together till the sun set. There came no janissary, however, on the morrow, as they expected, but on the eighth day Yusuf was summoned again to the Aga. The Jew at this message began to weep, making sure in his mind that a fresh dish of pork was prepared for him. However, he repaired obediently to the palace, where he was told that the favourite lady of the harem was indisposed, and the Aga commanded him to prescribe for her. Now, the Turks are very jealous of their mistresses, and disdain especially to expose them to the eyes of infidels, of whom the Jews are held the most vile. Wherefore, when Yusuf begged to see his patient, she was allowed to be brought forth only in a long white veil that reached down to her feet. The Aga, notwithstanding the folly of such a proceeding, forbade her veil to be lifted. Neither would he permit the Jew to converse with her, but commanded him on pain of death to return home and prepare his medicines. The wretched doctor, groaning all the way, went back to his house, without wasting a thought on what drugs he should administer on so hopeless a case, but considering instead the surgical practice of the Aga, which separated so many necks. However, he told his wife of the new jeopardy he was placed in for the Moorish Jezebel. "A curse take her," said Anna. "Give her a dose of poison, and let her perish before his eyes." "Nay," answered the Jew, "that will be to pluck the sword down upon our own heads. Nevertheless, I will cheat the infidel's concubine with some wine, which is equally damnable to their souls, and may God visit upon their conscience the misery they have enforced upon mine." In this bitter mood, going to a filthy hole in the floor, he drew out a flask of Shiraz, and bestowing as many Hebrew curses on the liquor as the Mussulmans are wont to utter of blessings over their medicines, he filled up some physic bottles and repaired with them to the palace. And now let the generous virtues of good wine be duly lauded for the happy sequel. The illness of the favourite, being merely a languor and melancholy, proceeding from the voluptuous indolence of her life. The draughts of Yusuf soon dissipated her chagrin, in such a miraculous manner that she sang and danced more gaily than any of her slaves. The Aga, therefore, instead of beheading Yusuf, returned to him all the purses of gold he had taken, to which the grateful lady besides added a valuable ruby, and henceforward, when she was ill, would have none but the Jewish physician. Thus Yusuf saved both his head and his money, and, besides, convinced the Aga of the virtues of good wine, so that the golden cup was finally emptied, as well as the dish of silver. End of The Golden Cup and the Dish of Silver by Thomas Hood. Read by Noel Badrian.